this is your first time here at St. Andrew's,
a special welcome to you. My name is Father Chris, and I'm the rector or senior pastor here. And we would love for you to fill out the Connect card that you can find in the pocket of the seat in front of you. That's way your way to introduce yourself to us so that we can introduce ourselves to you and find out how we can. We're really glad that you've chosen to spend your Good Friday evening with us here tonight. I want to invite Father Arnie to come up and say a few words about the service this evening before we begin. Everything you need for the service can be found either in your bulletin or on the screens above. It'll be duplicated in both places, so just follow along in whichever place feels most comfortable for you, and just experience the service as it comes.
We're now on the second act of the three acts of the mystery play of this season. I call it a mystery play because, much like Greek tragedies, they were something in which people were immersed and would take oftentimes more than a day, and the entire body of people becomes involved as participants in the drama. The first drama, of course, was last night when we were at the upper room. Now in the second act, we're at the cross. And then, of course, on Holy Saturday, we'll be at the tomb in the resurrected presence of our Lord. Now, this act is also a very ancient one. Much of what we're doing, again, is something that was done in Jerusalem in the 4th century. And we, over time, have picked it up. Many pilgrims had gone to see the events in Jerusalem, and they came back telling people in Northern Europe and other places about what they had seen and what they had heard. And indeed, in particular, one incredible woman, she was a woman probably from France, who in about the year 400 spent 2 years traveling as a pilgrim through Palestine, and she was a great writer, and so she wrote constantly about what she saw and what she'd heard and what she'd experienced. And she wrote in great detail about what the services were like in the Holy Sepulchre and in Jerusalem during Holy Week, which again was the three great days. And she said in particular that on the day of the cross, the day of crucifixion, people would gather in a plaza in front of where the cross had once stood and spent the day there in prayer and fasting with the reading of the Passion. And after that, they would have an exhortation, and then they would proceed into the church, and in the church they would do a series of things. One of them called the collex. The collex are short prayers that have a punch, and they exactly dictate to God what we're calling for. And so, and in the tradition, the deacon would intone to the congregation that they should kneel, and then the priest, after that was finished, would then say the collect, and then the deacon would chant, "Get up," and people would stand in silence until the next prayer. And that was a very important point. The prayers are very ancient, and they cover almost everything what we could think of. And then there are things called the reproaches, which are back actually from the Old Testament. And it's God talking to us about how we have offended him and our need to ask his forgiveness. And then the cross is brought in. And it's not the cross up there or a nice silver altar cross, but it's a rugged cross. And that cross is brought in by the deacon or whomever. And the person stops three times to say, "Behold the wood of the cross." It's intentional because at the Easter Vigil, the Paschal candle comes in, and the deacon says the same thing about the candle, "Behold the light of Christ." So there's a parallel between the two. And then once that's come in, people can pray and come forward to touch the cross if they wish. And then the fourth section is communion. The church universally does not celebrate communion on either Good Friday or Holy Saturday, the only 2 days of the year that we don't. But this is called the pre-sanctified gifts. The gifts that remained from last night were shown in a different place, and they'll be brought in. And then we can receive communion in a very simple way. and then we will have a final blessing and leave. And leaving in silence, I think, is important as well, as you're contemplating what you've experienced and seen.
All we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Let us pray. Almighty God, we beseech you graciously to behold this, your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed and given into the hands of sinners, and to suffer death upon the cross, who now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated as we read God's word.
A reading from the book of Genesis. After these things, God tested Abraham and said to him, "Abraham." And he said, "Here I am." He said, "Take your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains of which I shall tell you." So Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, and took two of his young men with him and his son Isaac. And he cut the wood for the burnt offering and arose and went to the place of which God had told him. On the third day, Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place from afar. Then Abraham said to his young men, "Stay here with the donkey. I and the boy will go over there and worship and come again to you." And Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on Isaac his son. And he took in his hand the fire and the knife. So they went, both of them together. And Isaac said to his father, "Abraham, my father." And he said, "Here I am, my son." And he said, "Behold, the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering?" Abraham said, "God will provide for himself the lamb for a burnt offering, my son." So they went, both of them together. When they came to the place of which God had told him, Abraham built the altar there and laid the wood in order and bound Isaac his son and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Then Abraham reached out his hand and took the knife to slaughter his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, "Abraham, Abraham." And he said, "Here I am." He said, Do not lay your hand on the boy or do anything to him. For now I know that you fear God, seeing you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me." And Abraham lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, behind him was a ram caught in a thicket by his horns. And Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called the name of that place, "The Lord will provide." As it is said, "To this day, on the mount of the Lord it shall be provided." And the angel of the Lord called to Abraham a second time from heaven and said, "By myself I have sworn, declares the Lord, because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will surely bless you, and I will surely multiply your offspring as the stars of heaven and as the sand that is on the seashore. And your offspring shall possess the gate of his enemies. And in your offspring shall all the nations of the earth be blessed, because you have obeyed my voice." The word of the Lord. Our psalm appointed for this evening is Psalm 69, verses 1 through 22. We will recite it responsibly by half verse. Save me, O God.
For the waters have come up even to my neck.
I sink down in the deep mire where there is no ground.
I have come to deep waters so that the floods come over me.
I am weary of crying, my throat is dry. Those who hate me without a cause are more than the hairs of my head.
Those who are my enemies and destroy me wrongfully.
They bid me restore things I never took.
O God, you know my foolishness, and my faults are not hidden from you.
Let not those who trust in you, O Lord God of hosts, be ashamed because of me. Surely for your sake have I suffered reproach.
Shame has covered my face.
I have become a stranger to my brethren.
Unknown to my mother's children.
Because zeal for your house has consumed me.
And the reproaches of those who reproach you have fallen upon me.
I wept and humbled myself with fasting.
But thou discerns my reproach.
I put on sackcloth also. Those who sit in the gates speak against me. But, Lord, I make my prayer to you. Hear me, O God, in the multitude of your mercy. Take me out of the mire, lest I sink. Let not the flood waters drown me, neither let the deep swallow me up. Hear me, O Lord, for your loving kindness is good.
Turn to me according to the multitude of your mercies.
And hide not your face from your servant, for I am in trouble.
O hasten and hear me.
Draw near to me and save me. You have known my reproach, my shame, and my dishonor.
My adversaries are all in your sight.
Reproach has broken my heart. I am full of heaviness.
I looked for something to have laid on me, but there was no one.
They gave me gall to eat.
Thirsty,
gave me vinegar to drink.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. For since the law has but a shadow of the good things to come, instead of the true form of these realities, it can never, by the same sacrifices that are continually offered every year, make perfect those who draw near. Otherwise, would they not have ceased to be offered, since the worshipers, having once been cleansed, would no longer have any consciousness of sins? But in these sacrifices, there is a reminder of sins every year. For it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. Consequently, when Christ came into the world, he said, "Sacrifices and offerings you have not desired, but a body have you prepared for me. And burnt offerings and sin offerings you have taken no pleasure. Then I said, 'Behold, I have come to do your will, O God, as it is written of me in the scroll of the book.'" When he said above, "You have neither desired nor taken pleasure in sacrifices and offerings and burnt offerings and sin offerings, these are offered according to the law." Then he added, "Behold, I have come to do your will." He does away with the first in order to establish the second. And by that will we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. And every priest stands daily at his service, offering repeatedly the same sacrifices which can never take away sins. But when Christ had offered for all time a single sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God, waiting from that time until his enemies should be made a footstool for his feet. For by a single offering, he has perfected for all time those who are being sanctified. And the Holy Spirit also bears witness to us, for after saying, "This is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my laws on their hearts and write them on their minds." Then he adds, "I will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more." Where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer any offering for sin. Therefore, brothers, since we have confidence to enter the holy places by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Out of my bondage, sorrow, and night, Jesus, I come, Jesus, I come. Into thy freedom, gladness, and light, Jesus, I come to thee. Out of my sickness, into thy health, out of my wanting, into thy wealth, out of my sin, and into thy sin. Out of my shameful failure and loss, Jesus, I come, Jesus, I come. Into the glorious gain of thy cross, Jesus, I come to thee. Out of earth's sorrows and into thy bonds, listen to jubilant song. Jesus, I come to thee. Out of the rest and arrogant pride, Jesus, I come, Jesus, I come. Into thy blessed will to abide, Jesus, I come to thee. Out of myself to dwell in thy love, out of despair into raptures above, upward forever on wings like a dove, Jesus, I come. Out of the fear and dread of the tomb, Jesus, I come, Jesus, I come. Into the joy and light of thy home, Jesus, I come to thee. Out of the depths of ruin untold, into the peace of thy sheltering, thy glorious face to behold, Jesus, I come to thee.
You may be seated. Mention of Golgotha, when we'll ask the congregation to stand.
When Jesus had spoken these words, he went out with his disciples across the brook Kidron, where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, for Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas, having procured a band of soldiers and some officers from the chief priests and the Pharisees, went there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that would happen to him, came forward and said to them,
"Whom do you seek?" "I am he."
Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. When Jesus said to them, "I am he," they drew back and fell to the ground. So he asked them again,
"Whom do you seek?"
"Jesus, Nazareth."
"I told you that I am he. So if you seek me, let these men go."
This was to fulfill the word that had been spoken, "Of those whom you gave me, I have lost none." Then Simon Peter, having a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's servant and cut off his ear. The servant's name was Malchus. So Jesus said to Peter,
"Put your sword in its sheath. Shall I not drink the cup the Father has given me?"
So the band of soldiers and their captain and officers of the Jews arrested Jesus and bound him. First, they led him to Annas, for he was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had advised the Jews that it would be expedient that one man should die for the people. Simon Peter followed Jesus, and so did another disciple. Since that disciple was known to the high priest, he entered with Jesus into the courtyard of the high priest. But Peter stood outside at the door. So the other disciple, who was known to the high priest, went out and spoke to the servant girl who kept watch at the door and brought Peter in. The servant girl at the door said to Peter, "You also are one of the man's disciples, are you?" He said, "I am not." Now the servants and officers had made a charcoal fire because it was cold, and they were standing and warming themselves. Peter also was with them, standing and warming himself. The high priest then questioned Jesus about his disciples and his teaching. Jesus answered him,
"I have spoken openly to the world. I have always taught in synagogues and in the temple, where all Jews come together. I have said nothing in secret. Why do you ask me? Ask those who have heard me what I said to them. They know what I said."
When he had said these things, one of the officers standing by struck Jesus with his hand, saying, "Is that how you answer the high priest?" Jesus answered him,
"If what I said is wrong, bear witness about the wrong. But if what I said is right, why do you strike me?"
Annas then sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. So he said to him, "You also are not one of the disciples, are you?" He denied it and said, "I am not." One of the servants of the high priest, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked, "Did I not see you in the garden with him?" Peter again denied it, and at once a rooster crowed. Then they led Jesus from the house of Caiaphas to the governor's headquarters. It was early morning. They themselves did not enter the governor's headquarters, so that they would not be defiled, but could eat the Passover. So Pilate went outside to them and said,
"What accusation do you bring against this man?"
"If this man were not doing evil, we would not have delivered him over to you."
"Take him yourselves and judge him by your own law."
The Jews said to him,
"It is not lawful for us to put anyone to death."
This was to fulfill the word that Jesus had spoken to show by what kind of death he was going to die. So Pilate entered his headquarters again and called Jesus and said to him, "Are you the King of the Jews?"
"Do you say this of your own accord, or do others say it to you about me?"
"Am I a Jew? Your own nation and the chief priests have delivered you over to me. What have you done?"
"My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would have been fighting, that I might not be delivered over to the Jews. But my kingdom is not of this world."
"So you are a king?"
"You say that I am a king. For this purpose I was born, and for this purpose I have come into the world, to bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth listens to my voice."
"What is truth?"
After he had said this, he went back outside to the Jews and told them, "I find no guilt in him, but you have a custom that I should release one man for you at the Passover. So do you want me to release to you the King of the Jews?" They cried out again,
"Not this man,
but Barabbas."
Now Barabbas was a robber. Then Pilate took Jesus and flogged him, and the soldiers twisted together a crown of thorns and put it on his head and arrayed him in a purple robe. They came up to him saying, "Hail, King of the Jews," and struck him with their hands. Pilate went out again and said to them,
"See, I am bringing him out to you, that you may know that I find no guilt in him."
So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them,
"Behold the man."
Now when the chief priests and the officers saw him, they cried out, "Crucify him, crucify him." Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves and crucify him, for I find no guilt in him."
The Jews answered him,
"We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die, because he has made himself the Son of God."
When Pilate heard this statement, he was even more afraid. He entered his headquarters again and said to Jesus,
"Where are you from?"
But Jesus gave him no answer. So Pilate said to him,
"You will not speak to me? Do you not know that I have authority to release you and authority to crucify you?"
"You would have no authority over me at all unless it had been given to you from above. Therefore, he who delivered me over to you has the greater sin." From then on, Pilate sought to release him, but the Jews cried out,
"If you release this man, you are not Caesar's friend."
"Everyone who makes himself a king opposes
Caesar."
So when Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and sat down on the judgment seat at a place called the Stone Pavement, and in Aramaic, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation of the Passover. It was about the sixth hour. He said to the Jews,
"Behold your king."
"Away with him, away with him, crucify him."
"Shall I crucify your king?"
The chief priests answered, "We have no king but Caesar." So he delivered him over to them to be crucified.
Please stand.
So they took Jesus, and he went out bearing his own cross to the place called the Place of a Skull, which in Aramaic is called Golgotha. They crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, and Jesus between them. Pilate also wrote an inscription and put it on the cross. It reads, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this inscription, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Aramaic, in Latin, and in Greek. So the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, "Do not write 'the King of the Jews,' but rather, 'This man said, I am the King of the Jews.'" Pilate answered,
"What I have written, I have written."
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his garments and divided them into four parts, one part for each soldier, also his tunic. But the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from top to bottom. So they said to one another, "Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it to see whose it will be, shall be." This was to fulfill the scripture which says, "They divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots." So the soldiers did these things, but standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple, whom he loved, standing nearby, he said to his mother,
"Woman, behold your son."
Then he said to the disciple,
"Behold your mother."
And from that hour, the disciple took her to his own home. After this, Jesus, knowing that all was now finished, said, to fulfill the scripture,
"I thirst."
A jar full of sour wine stood there. So they put a sponge full of sour wine on a hyssop branch and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the sour wine, he said,
"It is finished."
And he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Since it was the day of preparation, and so that the bodies would not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath was a high holy day, the Jews and Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once there came out blood and water. He who saw it bore witness, his testimony is true, and he knows that he is telling the truth, that you also may believe. For these things took place that the scripture might be fulfilled. Not one of his bones will be broken. And again, another scripture says, they will look on him with whom they have pierced.
Pray with me. Father, reveal to us our need for you and for the cross, and help us to experience afresh the forgiveness of our sins and the justification that comes by your grace alone. Help us to feel ourselves clothed with a new garment of righteousness in your presence. In Christ's name, amen. You may be seated. The cross of Christ accomplished many things, and the scriptures are clear about all the different ways that Jesus conquered sin, that he banished incorruption or corruptibility, that he purchased us out of slavery, that he washed us clean. There's all kinds of different imagery in the scriptures about what Christ did. But tonight, I want to focus in on one of those aspects of Christ's death and what it accomplished. And it happens to be explained in our epistle reading in Hebrews that Jackson read for us. And I want to start off by talking a little bit about what it's like to be unclean. So when I was a kid growing up, I used to run wild through the woods out in the country where I grew up, just west of here in Plain City. And we lived, we had 3 acres of woods, and we lived on the Little Darby Creek. And so I would run through the Little Darby Creek with the neighbor boys. There were four of them. God bless their mother. And I would sometimes even spray water on purpose into exposed dirt on the ground and make mud and rub it on myself. I have pictures of myself with a big M scratched into the mud because I was mud man. I just wanted to be dirty and thought that was a lot of fun. My next door neighbor friend, Luke, and I, we were the same age and we played football. We'd call each other on our landline. Remember those? And we would get out in the yard on rainy days. We'd say, hey, you want to go do hitting drills? So we'd put on all of our football gear and we'd do hitting drills in the yard in the pouring rain. So we thought that was a blast, of course, in the summer when it's warm. And so I would come back in from all these different activities, a mess, right? And you can imagine, you know, I'd kick off my shoes, I'd probably take off the pads or whatever, and I'd open the door from the garage into the laundry room to go into our house, and I'd hear my mom go, ah, ah, ah. Don't come in here. Don't track that mud in my house. Strip down and take it all off in the garage. If it was warm enough out, even if it wasn't warm out, go hose down, hose yourself off, and she'd bring me a towel, and I'd towel off. And so what did I have to do? I had to get clean. And this dilemma is a biblical one. From the very beginning, there's a place where we belong. There's a home that we were designed for with God that's clean. And we go out into the world, and because of our sin, we become unclean. And throughout all of Scripture, God is about the business of solving this dilemma, of creating a way to cleanse his people, to bring them back into fellowship with him. Because he's not going to change the standards of the house. It's going to stay holy. But he's going to do something about the ones that he loves. And so today we're going to look at this together. I want to illustrate the point even more in Israel's story, and not just in my own story, but in the biblical text, we see when God goes to great lengths to pull Israel out of, to draw them out, that's what Moses means, by the way, to draw them out of the nation, or out of the land of Egypt, He sends plagues. He does. It's been 400 years in the making. I mean, it is a wild ride if you read Exodus 1 through 16 or 17. And when you get to 19, the Lord says to Moses, he brings them finally to Mount Sinai. They're going to meet with God, and he says to them, warn the people. Warn them, lest they break through to the Lord to look, and many of them perish. Also, let the priests who come near to the Lord consecrate themselves, lest the Lord break out against them. So the regular people and the priests are all in danger of the holiness of God. The presence of God is kind of like bleach or lye. It purifies, but it's dangerous. After Moses goes up and he gets the Ten Commandments, they're all at the bottom of the mountain, and he goes up, gets a special access to God. Comes down, and all the people saw the thunder and the flashes of lightning, the sound of the trumpet, the mountain smoking. This is one of my favorite scenes in the whole Bible. The people were afraid, and they trembled. Which, yeah, that makes sense, doesn't it? They were afraid and trembled, and this is tragic. They stood far off and said to Moses, "You speak to God for us, and we'll listen, but don't let God speak to us, lest we die." Lest we die. The people stood far off, and Moses was the only one who drew near to the thick darkness where God was. So how do we get from a whole nation standing far off because they're afraid of dying in the presence of God to our reading today saying, we have confidence to enter the holy places? What? Confidence? They used to tie a rope around the high priest when he went into the holy places in case he did die so they could pull him out. Do you know that? Let us draw near with a true heart and full assurance. What? All of us, not just the high priest. What happened? How did we go from being a muddy mess who wasn't allowed in the house to being fully confident I could walk in the door? And it was cleansing. It was cleansing. And here in the letter of Hebrews, we see explained to us that we are cleansed. And so God is holy. We are sinful. God must purify us. And we have full access to our good Father because of that. So God is holy. There's a standard. We are sinful. We become unclean. God must purify us. And then we have full access to our good Father in that order. Okay, so first point, God is holy. What do we mean by this, God being holy? Well, we talked a little bit about this at Mount Sinai, right? But Catherine Sonderegger, a Lutheran theologian, says, the holy God is fiery, a living explosion. I love that terminology. At the end of Hebrews 10, in this exact chapter that we read today, further on, it says, it's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. God's holiness is a purifying light. He dwells in unapproachable light. And one of the implications of that holiness is that his ways are not our ways. Isaiah tells us this. My thoughts, God says, are not your thoughts. And my ways are not your ways, declares the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, which is at the time was immeasurable because they didn't have rockets, so are my ways higher than your ways and my thoughts than your thoughts, says the Lord. God has a standard in a way in which he designed this world to make and that he designed this world to operate, and he expects the world to operate in that way. And he is tirelessly and ruthlessly committed to eliminating the things that vandalize that good design. The bad news is we're one of the chief actors in vandalizing God's goodness in this world. So God is holy, but second, we are sinful. We're sinful. And we make ourselves unclean. This isn't something that's just done to us. This is something that we do. We perpetrate. We've offended against his holy law, our prayer book says. Adam and Eve were made near God, and then they rebelled against God, and then what happened? He had to remove them from the garden. There's this distance created. The dilemma is introduced into the story. And the same thing in Exodus 19, like we read about there. They have to stay far off. There's this distance, this gap. And then when he creates the temple, there's a curtain. There are walls. There's many curtains that function as walls as they're traveling. And then when they built the permanent temple, they had actual walls made out of wood to divide the common from the holy. So the dilemma persists. And in your life and in my life, don't you feel the dilemma? The impurity, the sin. Part of what we're doing this week and what we're doing throughout all of Lent is getting ourselves to a place where, yeah, we can say, I am a sinner. Woe is me. And because of sin, we cannot go in. So here's the great dilemma. What is God going to do about it? So third, God must purify us. Because of God's holiness and our sin, God must purify us. To solve the problem of distance and defilement from sin, God provided originally a regular sacrifice of animals to pay for the sins and to cleanse and purify the people. And this washing happened every day, twice a day. It happened annually on a national scale. And the wages of sin is death. The Bible tells us there can be, without the shedding of blood, there can be no forgiveness of sins, the Bible tells us. Blood had to be shed for the forgiveness of sins. And it was sprinkled against things to purify the different vessels in the temple. And the people themselves had to wash. And here's what it says in Hebrews, in our chapter, in verse 1. The law was but a shadow of the good things to come. So this practice of sacrificing animals to cleanse things with the blood, to pay for sin, it could never, it says, by the same sacrifices continually offered, make perfect those who draw near. If I fling the blood on you, it's not going to cleanse your heart. Your soul is not cured of sin because of the animal blood. Something greater had to come. Something greater had to come. And this is what the author of the Hebrews is, of the letter to the Hebrews is saying. If you got perfected, you wouldn't need to repeat the sacrifice. If you were perfected, you wouldn't need to repeat the sacrifice. But God commanded the repetition, the repeated action of these sacrifices because he knew they would be constantly needed. So the animal sacrifices were temporary and provisional because they weren't finally effective. They weren't ultimately effective. They were pointing to something greater, even though God honored them under a certain covenant to be the way that his people could draw near. So it was good, but it wasn't ultimate. You see that? Okay, so when Christ came, verse 5 tells us of our passage, it says that the sacrifices and the offerings of the law were put away because a body had been prepared, a new sacrifice had been prepared. And Christ was here to do the will of God. This greater sacrifice was offered. And that offering was the very body of the Son of God himself. Christ's death on the cross is this greater offering, this true form of what was a shadow and animal sacrifice. And so how does that work? How do we get from Jesus dying on the cross 2,000 years ago to purifying the sins in the hearts of all people who would believe in him? How do we get there? Well, number one, we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once and for all. Jesus Christ is not just another man. If you were to put all the people in the world, all the beautiful things you've ever seen, the greatest mountains, the greatest joys, the highest heights, the most beautiful music, all of it on one side of the scale, and you put one drop of the blood of Jesus Christ on the other side, he outweighs it all. And so the precious Son of God goes innocently, I thirst. The one who gives streams of living water thirsts. The one who is innocent dies as guilty. I'll let Melito of Sardis give us a beautiful description of this. The Lord clothed himself with humanity and with suffering on behalf of the suffering one, and bound on behalf of the one constrained. He was judged on behalf of the one convicted and buried on behalf of the one entombed. The one who didn't need to go went. And this purification, this sanctification is once for all. You see, in the old system, again, the priest had to sacrifice daily and was sacrificing for himself, the letter to the Hebrews tells us. But the true form, the ultimate reality of those sacrifices were pointing to this death, which is once for all. So the first way that it's superior to the previous sacrifices is that it's once and for all. It's not repeated because it is sufficient for the sins of the whole world. In the temple, you had an altar for burning, you had tables for incense, you had basins for washing, you had all kinds of things. But you know what piece of furniture was missing in the temple that Christ has in heaven? A chair. When he entered into the heavenly place, he sat down. Because why? He was finished. It was finished. The priests were constantly working in the old temple. They couldn't sit down. They didn't have time to sit down. There's too many sins to pay for. But then they went and they sat down. When he went into the heavenly temple, he sat down, and Sabbath rest is granted for all time because it is the once for all sufficient sacrifice paid by the Son of God. The second way it's superior is not only is it sufficient for the whole world and once for all, but it's applied to us in a supernatural way that wasn't available before. How does the benefit and the effect of the blood of God, the blood of Christ, get applied to you? It's by the indwelling Holy Spirit. When Christ ascends to the right hand of the Father, and the Father hands him over the Holy Spirit, he now, as King of the universe and as the great high priest who ascends with his hands outstretched in blessing, he then sends the Holy Spirit into the world, and like a brush in the hand of the Father, the Spirit smears the blood of Christ across the souls of every Christian. Like at the Passover. We'll actually say this at our Easter vigil tomorrow night, that he paints the blood of the Lamb on the doorpost of our hearts. And so what Christ accomplished in paying for sin is not just out there that we have to go find it, but when you believe in Christ, the Spirit comes and dwells inside of you, and he applies it to your life by grace. Instead of, we just read about this as well, instead of some kind of external code, the law is now written on your heart. What is that? That's the indwelling Spirit, writing the law, fulfilling the law in your heart. Romans 8 says a lot about this. And instead of paying the penalty of sin every time you sin, the penalty of sin is now paid once and for all. So what does that mean? In conclusion, God is holy, we are unclean, and we need to be cleansed. He wipes away the sin once and for all by the one sacrifice, and it's applied, his righteousness is applied to us by the indwelling Holy Spirit. We are made clean once and for all, and we're made fit to enter the presence of God now with full confidence. Before there was a division, the holy God is there, we have to stay out here, but now, because Christ has made you holy once and for all, the curtain is torn in two. There's no longer a curtain separating the holy place where God is and the common place where we are. The new curtain, the text tells us, is the body of Christ. And if you're united to Christ, if you are the body of Christ, you have access to the Father through your faith in him. The doorway was thrown wide. The passageway to God was cleared open. And you and I can now do what the letter to the Hebrews pleads with us to do. He says, therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence, several senses, conditional statements here, and then he gives us the punchline. Since we have confidence to enter the holy places by the blood of Jesus, and by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is his flesh, and since we have a great high priest over the house of God, here it is, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith. The only sane response to this news is to draw near. Like, the only thing that you ought to do when you hear that Christ has purified you and given you full access to the Father who created all things, who created you, who loves you, is to then draw near. Not to stand far off in fear, not to stand far off in apathy, not to stand far off in complacency, but it's to run to him. That's the only sane response to this good news. Anything else means we're not getting it. So my question today is, have you come to know that Jesus Christ died for you to have this? For you. Do you know that the one whom you owe an impossible debt to paid the debt off for you? Just totally paid it off. Did you know it's because he loves you? Not because he was obligated. He doesn't just put up with you like at a family reunion or something. No, he like likes you. He wants you to be with him. He delights over you. Did you know that he rejoices and celebrates over getting you back to himself? There's like, Jesus taught on this explicitly. This isn't something I'm making up. He rejoices. He throws the party like the prodigal son because he's so affectionate over you. He allures you with his grace. He draws you in with his grace. Catherine Parr, who is famous for being married to Henry VIII, which is not as impressive as what she did after he died, which was publish her own book on her own spiritual journey, first woman to publish under her own name in English. And she published something called The Lamentation of a Sinner in 1548. And it is an epic sort of a description of the inner workings of someone who's discovering this for themselves and feeling this. So she hears, she meditates on the comfortable words that we say every week in the liturgy. The comfortable words right after the confession where we say, we have a propitiation, someone who bears up the wrath for our sin. Come to me, all you who are heavy laden in labor, and I will give you rest. The saying is true and trustworthy. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. She's reflecting on these comfortable words, and she says, what gentle, merciful, comfortable words are these to all sinners? That's you and me. What a most gracious, comfortable, and gentle saying was this, with such pleasant and sweet words to allure his enemies to come to him. That's you and me, his enemies. When I behold the beneficence, like the goodwill, the liberality, mercy and goodness of the Lord, I am encouraged, I'm emboldened, and I'm stirred to ask for such a noble gift as living faith. By this faith I am assured. Hear that from Hebrews? And by this assurance I feel the remission of my sins. I feel the guilt and the shame gone. I feel it gone. This is it that maketh me bold, she says. This is it that comforteth me. This is it that quencheth all despair. Thus, and I love this line, I feel myself to come, as it were, in a new garment before God. And now, by his mercy, to be taken, to be regarded as just and righteous. Sweet words to allure his enemies. I feel the remission of my sins. I feel myself in a new garment before God. I'm taken as just and righteous. These are the words of a woman who has experienced the purification of the Lamb of God for herself. My youngest daughter's middle name is Catherine for this very reason. These are the words of a woman who has experienced the death of Christ for her. And so have you? Do you know that he loves you? That he paid the price? If not, if so, I beg you to do what the writer of the letter to the Hebrews says and draw near with confidence. Don't stop. Keep drawing near. Keep drawing near. You might get tired of it because you're a human and you get tired of things, but God is not tired of it. And if you don't know this for yourself, I beg you to beg God to give you an experience of his grace that you've never had before and to draw near. After all, this is why Christ died. To the glory of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Dear people of God, our Heavenly Father sent his Son into the world, not to condemn the world, but that the world might through him be saved, that all who believe in him might be delivered from the power of sin and death and become heirs with him of everlasting life. We pray, therefore, for people everywhere according to their needs.
Let us pray for the Holy Church throughout the world, that the Lord our God may preserve her in unity, peace, and safety, bringing her into divine subjection, all powers and principalities, and that he may grant us to dwell in such peace and tranquility that we may show forth the glory of God.
Please kneel if you're able. Almighty Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church. Fill it with all truth, in all truth, with all peace. Where it is corrupt, purify it. Where it is in error, direct it. Where in anything it is amiss, reform it. Where it is right, strengthen it. Where it is in want, provide for it. Where it is divided, reunite it. For the sake of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior. Amen.
Let us pray for Mark, our bishop, and for Foley, our archbishop, that the Lord our God, who has appointed them to this office, may preserve them in health and safety for the governance of God's holy people.
Almighty and everlasting God, whose judgment upholds all things both in heaven and on earth, as you have appointed these your servants to be our bishops, so also defend them by your mercy against all adversities, that we, acknowledging you as the great shepherd and overseer of our souls, may so prosper by their care that we may bring forth the fruit of righteousness through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons, and for all God's holy people.
Almighty and everlasting God, by whose Spirit the whole body of your faithful people is governed and sanctified, receive our supplications and prayers which we offer before you for all members of your holy church, that in their vocation and ministry they may truly and devoutly serve you, through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
Let us pray for Joseph, our president, and for all in civil authority, that they, knowing whose ministers they are, may above all things seek God's honor and glory, and that we, remembering whose authority they bear, may faithfully and obediently honor them in accordance with God's holy word.
Almighty God, whose kingdom is everlasting and whose power is infinite, we commend our nation to your merciful care, that being guided by your providence, we may dwell secure in your peace. Grant to our president and to all in authority wisdom and strength to know and to do your will. Fill them with the love of truth and righteousness, and make them ever mindful of their calling to serve this people in your fear. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray for those who are preparing for holy baptism, that the Lord our God may open their hearts to his grace and mercy, that by the washing of regeneration, they may obtain the remission of their sins and be found faithful servants of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Almighty and everlasting God, you multiply your church in every generation. Grant the gifts of faith and understanding to those being instructed in your holy word, that being washed in the waters of baptism, they may be born again and numbered among your adopted children. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray to God, the Father Almighty, that he would cleanse the world from all evil, deliver it from pestilence and famine, set free those who are in captivity, restore the sick to health, and bring those who travel to a haven of safety.
Gracious God, the comfort of all who sorrow, the strength of all who suffer, let the cry of those in misery and need come to you, that they may find your mercy present with them in all their afflictions, and give us, we pray, the strength to serve them for the sake of him who suffered for us, your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray for all who are in heresy or schism, that the Lord our God may deliver them from all false doctrine and restore them to faith and unity of the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church.
O God of truth and love, who desires not the death of sinners, but rather that they should turn from their wickedness and live, look with mercy on those who are deceived by the lies of the world, the flesh, and the devil, that the hearts of those who have gone astray may be restored to wisdom and returned to the way of truth in the unity of your holy church, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray for the Jewish people, that the Lord our God may look graciously upon them, and that they may come to know Jesus as the Messiah and as the Lord of all.
Almighty and everlasting God, you established your covenant with Abraham and his hear the prayers of your church, that the people through whom you brought blessing to the world may also receive the blessing of salvation, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray for all of those who do not believe in Christ, that the Holy Spirit may enlighten them through the gospel and bring them into the way of salvation.
Merciful Creator of all the peoples of the earth and lover of souls, have compassion on all who do not know you as you are revealed in your Son, Jesus Christ. Let your gospel be preached with grace and power to those who have not heard it. Turn the hearts of those who resist it, and bring home to your fold those who have gone astray, that there may be one flock under one shepherd, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us commit ourselves to our God and pray for the grace of a holy life, that with all who have died in the peace of Christ and those whose faith is known to God alone, we may be accounted worthy to enter into the fullness of the joy of our Lord and receive the crown of life in the day of resurrection.
O God of unchangeable power and eternal light, look favorably on your whole church, that wonderful and sacred mystery. By the effectual working of your providence, carry out in tranquility the plan of salvation. Let the whole world see and know that things which were cast down are being raised up, and things which had grown old are being made new, and that all things are being brought to their perfection by him through whom all things were made, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. You may be seated. As the choir assembles the anthem this evening, I want to take an opportunity to invite you all to come back tomorrow or on Sunday for our Easter celebrations. As Father Arnie was saying, this is only part two of a three-part liturgy, and part three happens tomorrow with the Easter Vigil. In the evening, we'll gather here at 8:30. We'll gather with a bonfire. We'll have a candlelight portion of the service as we read through salvation history from various passages of the Old Testament. And then we'll have our first Easter Eucharist together. And then if 8:30 on Saturday isn't a good time for you, you can come back on Sunday for 9 o'clock or 11:15, whichever time works best for you. But this is the height of our annual celebration of what Christ has done for us in his death, but also in his resurrection. So stay tuned for more. Please come back tomorrow or Sunday. We'd love to see you there. Also, for children, tomorrow morning, we have a special Easter teaching and celebration at 9:30 with an Easter egg hunt. So if you know any children in your life, whether they're your own children or your grandchildren or your neighbor children or your friend's children, bring them. We'd love to see them here tomorrow at 9:30 in the morning. We'd love to see you there. Finally, if you'd like to support the work of St. Andrew's with a financial gift tonight, we do have offering baskets at the back of the church. We're not going to pass them around tonight, but if you want to make a gift, they're there on your way out. And we will exit in silence. One final word about communion. All Christians who have been baptized in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit are welcome to receive communion from the sacrament tonight. When the ushers will invite you to come up, please move from the outside of the altar rail towards the center. I'll come by with bread first, and we do have gluten-free bread available if you need it. And then you can either eat the bread right away, drink from the common cup chalice, hold on to the bread, dip it in the intinction chalice. And if you're not receiving communion tonight for any reason, you're also welcome to come forward for a blessing. Just cross your arms over your chest like this, and I will bless it. "Behold the wood of the cross, on which was hung the world's salvation." Behold the wood of the cross, on which was hung the world's salvation. Behold the wood of the cross, on which was hung the world's salvation. Oh, my people, what have I done to you? How have I wearied you? Testify against me. I brought you forth from the land of bondage and led you through the waters of salvation, and you have prepared a cross for your Savior. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one, have mercy upon us. I led you through the desert 40 years, and fed you with the bread of heaven. I brought you into the land of promise, and you have prepared a cross for your Savior. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one, have mercy upon us. What could I have done for you that I have not done? I planted you my vineyard to bear sweet fruit. But you have become very bitter to me and gave me vinegar for my thirst. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one, have mercy upon us. I passed over your firstborn and delivered them from death, and you have delivered me into the hands of my enemies. I led you in the pillar of cloud, and you have led me into the judgment hall of Pilate. O my people, what have I done to you? How have I wearied you? Testify against me. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one, have mercy upon us. I struck down the kings of the Canaanites for your sake, and you struck my head with a reed. I gave you a royal inheritance, and you have crowned my head with thorns. O my people, what have I done to you? How have I wearied you? Testify against me. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one, have mercy upon us. I opened the rock and gave you to drink from the water of life, and you have opened my side with a spear. I raised you on high with great power, and you have hanged me high upon the cross. O my church, what have I done to you? How have I wearied you? Testify against me. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one, have mercy upon us. As we sing the next two songs, I invite you to come forward in turns, and you can kneel before the cross. Feel free to lay a hand on it or kiss it or offer your devotions in whatever you way as you reflect upon what Jesus has done for you on the cross. Feel free also to remain seated and just worship where you are.
Your cross, O Lord, taught me to see that though I fail you every day, your steadfast love will not fail me, but gladly bears my sin away. And there I see your holy fire, consuming sin in mercy's blood. What righteousness and love require to ransom sinners to their God. Your cross, O Lord, taught me to weep, for there my sin led you away. And e'en the sun did bow in grief as darkness crowned our darkest day. And oh, to think that I once stood indifferent to your suffering. And oh, to see your sweat like blood, such depths of sorrow born for me. So, Lord, taught me to love, for there I've tasted a love divine. It fills my heart with power enough to make your costly service mine. No sin too great to meet with grace, no enemy too foul to bless. Your love in of sacrifice, teach me, O Lord, to love like this. The cross, O Lord, taught me to see, for now my captive soul is free. No guilt, no fear, no suffering can tear away your love. No song can reach such heights of joy. No tongue can tell such depths of peace. No power, no time can e'er destroy the eternal praise for Calvary. Glorious battle of the mighty conflict sing. Tell the triumph of the victim, to his cross thy tribute bring. Jesus Christ, the world's Redeemer, from that cross now reigns as King. 30 years among us dwelling is appointed time fulfilled. Born for this he meets his passion, this the Savior freely. Across the Lamb is lifted, where his precious blood is spilled. He endures the nails, the spitting, vinegar and spear and reed. From that holy body broken, blood and water.
sweetest hire, sweetest weight is hung on thee. Bend thy boughs, O tree of glory, thy relaxing sins bend. For a while the ancient rigor that thy birth bestowed suspend, and the King of heavenly beauty gently on thine arms extend. Praise and honor to the Father, praise and honor to the Son, praise and honor to the Spirit, ever three and ever one in might and one in glory, while eternal ages
all who truly and earnestly repent of your sins and seek to live in love and charity with your neighbors and intend to lead the new life, following the commandments of God and walking in his holy ways, draw near with faith and make your humble confession to Almighty God. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker and judge of us all, we acknowledge and lament our many sins and offenses, which we have committed by thought, word, and deed against your divine majesty, provoking most justly your righteous anger against us. We are deeply sorry for these our transgressions. The burden of them is more than we can bear. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may evermore serve and please you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who in his great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all those who sincerely repent and with true faith turn to him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We're about to pray the Lord's Prayer. On Good Friday, we omit the traditional doxology at the end of the prayer, so be aware of that as we pray. Let us now pray in the words our Savior Christ has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. The body of our Lord Jesus Christ.
of the darkest day, Christ on the road to Calvary, tried by sinful men, torn and beaten then, nailed to a cross of wood. This the power of the cross. Christ became sin for us, took the blame, bore the wrath we stand forgiven at the cross. Oh, to see the pain written on your face, bearing the awesome weight of sin. Every bitter thought, every evil deed, crowning your blood-stained brow. This the power of the cross. Christ became sin for us, took the blame, bore the wrath we stand forgiven at the cross. Now the daylight, the ground beneath quakes as its maker bows his head. Dirt and torn in two, dead are raised to life. Finish the victory cry. Oh, this the power of the cross. My name written in the wounds, for through your suffering I am free. Death is crushed to death, and life is mine to live. Won through your selfless
please stand. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, we pray you to set your passion, cross, and death between your judgment and our souls. Now and in the hour of our death, give mercy and grace to the living, peace and rest to the dead, to your holy church, unity and concord, and to us sinners, everlasting life and glory. For with the Father and the Holy Spirit, you live and reign, one God, now and forever. Amen.